Let's do this. Beginning with compunction, were there any passages, sayings, that you specifically wanted to address, ask a question about, etc.? Now, what is compunction? Anybody look it up? I mean, Benedict Award talks about it a little bit somewhere in the introduction. I don't think I've got it necessarily marked with anything. But it's the, you know, it's the inward sense of sin. And and of one's sinfulness, okay, being aware of one's sinfulness. So, if you don't have anything to address, look at number 14. Athanasius of Holy Memory asked Pambo to come down from the desert to Alexandria. When he arrived, he saw a woman that was an actress, and he wept. The bystanders asked him why he wept. And he said, two things grieved me. The first was her condemnation. The second, that I take less trouble about pleasing God than she takes about pleasing the worst of mankind. Okay, now, you got to put yourself in this period. Actors / actresses were not like actors and actresses today for our society. Because in our society, I don't know if it's the vast majority of people, but the majority of people look up to actors and actresses. In their early church period, they looked down on actors and actresses. Okay, for largely the same reason a lot of people look down on actors and actresses today, their lifestyles, okay? Actors and actresses in this period had very loose lifestyles, let's say. And so he says, you know, here's what grieves me. The first, her condemnation. He's not talking about her condemnation in society. He's talking about impending condemnation, okay? Judgment. The second, he takes her as kind of a reference point and says, you know, she spends her time, what, trying to please the worst of mankind. And he says, and I spend less time or take less trouble trying to please God than she does trying to please humanity. So what he does is he uses her kind of as a focal point to look at himself. Okay. He's not damning her by any means. He's saying she's a model not to be followed. Okay, or she is a model to be followed, but to take her model and apply it to attempting to please God rather than humanity. Okay, go on down to number 16, Synclitica. All must endure great travail and conflict when they are first converted to the Lord, but later they have unspeakable joy. They are like people trying to light a fire. The smoke gets in their eyes begin to water, but they succeed in what they want. In other words, he's talking about the conversion process begins, like, or she, begins, you're trying to start a fire. It's not easy at the beginning. Smoke gets in your eyes, okay? Probably alluding to that in this period, you know, it could take 3 years or so to become a Christian, right? But once the fire is started, you have what you have sought. It is written, our God is a consuming fire, and so we must kindle divine fire with tears and trouble. The tears are that compunction, that sense of inner guilt, okay, and trouble. Turn to number 24. A hermit said, notice, just an anonymous hermit said, as the shadow goes everywhere with the body, what? So we ought to carry penitence and weeping with us everywhere we go. Why? Because that sense of compunction ought to be on the mind continually, according to what this hermit is saying. Okay? Look at the one just before that. Another hermit, might be the same one, we don't know, sees somebody laughing and says, we have to render an account of our whole life before heaven and earth. And you can laugh? Now, what does this tell us about these hermits? Taylor?
Not exactly what people would call pleasant.
Okay, not exactly pleasant company. Not the kind of people you want to invite to the life of the party or be the life of the party. They're pretty serious, right? Okay, somewhere in, I don't think it's actually in this book. It's in Sayings of the Desert Fathers. I think it's the alphabetical collection. One of the monks mentions, where in the New Testament does it say Jesus laughed? Nowhere. We're told he wept. We're told he yells at the money changers in the temple. We're told he mourns. But we're never told that he laughs. Okay. They take that to mean that's an example to be followed. That if Christ, second person of the Trinity, Son of God, and all that, is never shown laughing at anything in the world, how can we? Okay, now, you know, if you sit there and really think about it, that's rather, one, damning, okay, to anybody who does laugh, okay? But it also, they would say, should be instructive. Because what does that mean about life in this world? It's not a laughing matter, okay? That what happens here is deadly serious, okay? Self-control. Were there any passages in the section on self-control that you wanted to address? Because keep in mind, self-control implies what or involves what? Okay, discipline. Okay.
Struggle, I guess.
Struggle. Against what?
Yourself.
Your own
laziness.
Your own, okay, you used a particular example. Laziness. What else? How about everything? Okay. Self-control in terms of, you know, getting up and, they were talking about you earlier, Krista, getting up and writing that paper that you don't want to write, you know, if you've got 15 or whatever the amount is due that you said, okay? Getting up and studying for that exam, getting up and go to work. My son remarked yesterday when we were on a short walk, you know, he's gotten to the point where he, you know, when he thinks of going to work, he works at Subway, he sometimes thinks suicide is a better answer. I mean, he is so tired of working at Subway. It's so, as he puts it, soul-sucking, okay? But self-control says you put that aside and you go and do whatever is next. I argue when I teach my Harry Potter class, you know, the whole Harry Potter series, as part of this idea of being prepared for death, you know, it's about learning self-control. I mean, that's the number one thing Harry has got to learn in book 7. Self-control. Because throughout, especially books 6 and 7, what's Harry dealing with, for those of you who have read the novels? He's got to find the Horcruxes. Does he have a roadmap? Does he know where he's going?
No.
So what happens? Mistake after mistake after mistake after mistake. What happens when he loses his wand? Anybody remember? What's the very next day?
Christmas.
Okay. He and Hermione go to Godric's Hollow, The name, by the way, is very significant. The name Godrick means kingdom of God. It's the hollow of the kingdom of God. What do they see when they first apparate into the town, the little village? There's a statue. Okay, it's a war memorial, first of all, because you cannot go into any town or village in England and not see a war memorial to World War I dead and World War II dead. So when they apparate and they start to walk past this war memorial, it changes. What does it become? Yeah. What's the image? Literally, you have an image of a man, a woman right next to him. She's cuddling a little baby who's looking up at her. And we're told all three of these images on this statue have snow, but it's only described as being around the rims of their heads. It's not described as covering the little baby. So what is the snow symbolic of? Halos. What family is this? Yeah. This is the Holy Family. Okay. Harry loses his wand when he goes to Batilda Bagshot's house. And the very next morning, he wakes up and he's looking out on a beautiful scene. And the narrator says, he should be full of life and joy and beauty. And instead, what's he full of? He thinks the universe is inconsequential. And he has a little teeny tiny infinitesimal spot in the universe is even more tiny and infinitesimal. And he doesn't mean anything. That this is just blind, absurd chance. Okay? So what has happened? Harry has gone to the lowest of the low points. It's at that moment that what begins to happen in the novel? Yeah, he starts to rise. Because what happens that very same day? The doe in the woods leads him to what? A great big silver cross in water. Okay, turns out to be the sword of Godrick Gryffindor, etc. What's being shown there? When Harry reaches that low point, he's lost all self-control. What's he doing? He is having the world's biggest pity party. My life sucks. I've lost the wand, the one thing that protects me against Voldemort. My parents are dead because he sees their grave. And he says, you know, they don't care a rat's you know what for me. Why? Because they're 6 feet under. They're moldering. Nobody cares about me. Everybody's out to get me, except for Hermione, it seems like. Boo-hoo-hoo. And it's after that that he starts to learn self-control. Okay? Self-control. Number eight. Unless you've got one you want to discuss. Once Agatho was going on a journey with his disciples. One of them found a small bag of green peas on the road and said to him, Abba, if you say so, I will pick it up. Did you put it there? No. Why do you want to pick up something you did not put down? I mean, come on. Finders keepers, right? No. No. What does he mean? Why do you want to pick up something you did not put down? To whom does the bag of peas belong? The world? God? Whoever put it there or dropped it there? Okay. So why is this about self-control? What does the man say? If you want me to, he doesn't just lean over and pick it up. He is showing some self-control at the beginning. Okay. Agatho wants to increase that. Okay. Why pick up something you didn't lay down? go on to number 19, John the Short. If I remember right, this is a, this guy, the way his name is usually translated is John the Dwarf, not John the Short. John the Short's a little more, you know, politically correct, let's say. If a king wants to take a city filled with his enemies, he first captures their food and water. And when they're starving, he subdues them. Nice little image. So it is with gluttony. If a man is sincere about fasting and is hungry, the enemies that trouble his soul will grow weak. Okay, so what's he saying? Gluttony is the enemies that trouble his soul. So how do you subdue those enemies? By fasting. You starve them out. Does he say anywhere this is going to be easy? No. In fact, what they all say, always say, is it's going to be hard. That's why Synclectica said, you know, what do you have to do when you start that fire? You have to work at it. Yeah, smoke's going to get in your eyes. Yeah, your hands might get burned. But once you achieve the goal, the fire being started, then it will be easier. What John the Short is also implying is, once you fasted a little, then what? Fasting more becomes even easier. Okay? So once you practice that self-control and deny yourself something, then denying yourself more and more and more gets easier and easier and easier. No, I don't want to do that. It's too long. 28. Macarius. There were several Macariuses. This is Macarius the Great, a desert father. Macarius said, if you're stirred to anger when you want to reprove someone, you are gratifying your own passions. That is, the reproving someone is merely a satisfying your own passion of anger. Do not lose yourself in order to save another. And in fact, what you're going to see, if you read through the entire book, is one thing they will almost all say is, don't reprove your brother. Don't point out, point out your brother's sins or your brother's faults. Because what do you automatically do in doing that?
Judge.
Exactly. You judge someone else. You set yourself up above them. Whereas what they're always going to say, especially when we get to the section, if we get to the section on humility, is what should you do? You should put yourself beneath someone else. Okay? Number 44, another little example of self-control. Notice, by the way, self-control is a pretty long section. They've got a lot to say about self-control. Number 44, Sisyphus said, our form of pilgrimage, okay, now what is pilgrimage? It's a holy journey. It's moving from one place to a sought-out destination. Usually in worldly terms, it's going to a holy site, a holy city, a holy festival, something like that. Our form of pilgrimage that is moving from, let's use St. Augustine's terms, the earthly city to the celestial city, is keeping the mouth closed. What does St. James say in the book of James? The mouth is what? It's evil. It's out of the mouth that come all kinds of dangers, snares. That's why he talks about keeping the tongue tied up. Okay? Okay, I'm going to skip the rest of that. Go on to lust. Look at number five, unless you have one that you want to discuss. When Cyrus of Alexandria was asked about the temptation of lust, he said, "If you're not tempted, you have no hope." Okay, just let that sink in for a minute. If you are not tempted, you have no hope. If you're not tempted, it's because you're sinning. That is, you've already given in if you're not tempted. The man who does not fight sin at the stage of temptation is sinning already in his body. The man who is sinning in his flesh has no trouble from temptation. Why? Because it's not temptation. Temptation implies something appears outside of your body. You look at it, you examine it, you think, ooh, I really want to, but I shouldn't, or I don't want to. Okay, that's the temptation aspect. There's a tension. If there's no tension, then you must already be giving into it. Keep in mind, lust doesn't only have to be sexual lust. Lust can be lust of the eyes, lust of physical sexual desire. It can be lust for food. It can be lust for power. It can be any different kinds of desires. Okay? Number 10. They said of Sarah, one of the desert mothers, that for 13 years she was fiercely attacked by the demon of lust. She never prayed that the battle should leave her. But she used to say only, "Lord, give me strength." So why doesn't she pray that the battle would leave her? Why doesn't she pray, "Lord, take this, you know, demon away from me. Take this temptation away from me." Okay, why else? Okay, partially that. How does one show virtue? Or how does one learn virtue? Yeah, through a choice. Okay? Without the quote-unquote demon of lust, there's no choice. That is, she's not presented with, okay, do I choose to go this way or do I choose to go this way? Okay? So, you cannot have virtue without a choice, without any choice. So, if you're only given orders, there's no choice involved there. They also said of her that the same demon of lust was once attacking her threateningly, tempting her with vain thoughts of the world. She continued in the fear of God, maintained the rigor of her fasting. Once when she climbed up on the roof to pray, the spirit of lust appeared to her in bodily form and said to her, "You have overcome me, Sarah." Notice what she doesn't say. Hooray! No, it's not I who have overcome you, but my Lord Christ. Notice, she doesn't take any credit for it. Why? Because as St. Paul would say, it's because of Christ dwelling in her. Okay? Go on to number 20. I was looking at number 17, but decided not to do it. Number 20. Once the disciple of a great hermit was tempted by lust. When the hermit saw him struggling, he said, "Shall I ask the Lord to release you from your trouble?" Okay. So the great hermit is saying, "Shall I intercede to God on your behalf? Take away the demon from this poor disciple." The disciple replies, "Abba, I see that although it is a painful struggle, I am profiting from having to carry this burden." That is, this burden, this temptation is teaching me. It's purifying me. But ask God in your prayers that he will give me enough patience to endure it. Well, St. Paul says, no one is tempted beyond their ability to endure. That is, God doesn't allow any temptation to come to someone that is more than they're able to withstand. Then as Abba says to him, "Now I know that you are far advanced, my son, and beyond me." That is, the great hermit says to his student, "You are my master." Okay? Because the hermit says, "Do you want the spirit to leave you?" "No. Just pray to the Lord that he grant me the patience to endure." Okay? And the hermit learns from that. Go on to 33. A hermit used to say, "A lustful thought is brittle like papyrus. When it is thrust at us, if we do not accept it but throw it away, it breaks easily." What does he mean, if we do not accept it? What can you do with a temptation, a thought that comes to you? You can entertain it, right? You can say, "Come on in, sit down. Let's have a drink together," and kind of talk with that thought and give it some free rein. Okay? Giving it the free rein is not entirely giving in to the temptation. Giving in to the temptation, whatever form the temptation takes, is physically acting out upon it. Okay? I mean, that's the full 100% giving in. Allowing it into your mind and kind of letting it sit there and looking at it from all different angles and maybe reveling a little bit in it. Okay? That's moving towards the giving in. So, the hermit says, when that thought is thrust at us, if we don't accept it, that is, if we don't allow it in, but immediately bat it away, what happens? It shatters. If it allures us and we keep playing with it, it becomes as difficult to break as iron. That is, when you allow it to come in and take a seat in the conference room of your mind, then what are you doing? It becomes like a squatter in a house. It becomes really hard to remove that thought, okay? Because it becomes like a stain. It seeps in. We need discernment to know that those who consent to these thoughts lose hope of salvation. And for those who do not consent, a crown is made ready. Well, how do they lose hope of salvation? Because the hope of salvation is a thought. And partially what happens is, as if you're familiar with Lord of the Rings, Barnum and Butterbur famously says, "One thought drives out another." Okay? Right. Let's go on to section 6, possessing nothing. A brother was leaving the world, the very first one. A brother was leaving the world, and though he gave his goods to the poor, he kept some for his own use. He went to Antony, and when Antony knew what he had done, he said, "If you want to be a monk, go to the village over there, buy some meat, hang it on your naked body, and come back here." Okay, now pause for a minute. Why did Antony become a monk? Anybody remember? Exactly, because he was walking by a church one day, and he heard that passage, I think it's from Luke's gospel. "Go and sell all that you have and follow me." Okay. He was a rich young man. His parents were dead. He inherited everything. He did exactly what the gospel said. Went, sold all that he had, left some of the proceeds to take care of his sister, went off into the desert. Okay, so he knows a little bit of what he's speaking about. So this guy goes, sells everything he has, but keeps a little bit of the proceeds for himself. So Antony tells him, "You want to be a monk, go to that village, buy some meat, hang it on your naked body, and then come back. The brother went. Dogs and birds tore at his body. Can you just, you know, mentally picture this? Some guy walking around town naked, except for a bunch of slabs of steaks hanging all over him. And dogs, packs of dogs, and birds, vultures probably, attacking him. He came back to Antony, who asked him if he had done what he was told. He showed him his torn body. Then Antony said, "Those who renounce the world but want to keep their money are attacked in that way by demons and torn in pieces." Okay, so couldn't he have just told the guy this rather than have the poor guy attacked? What's the best way to learn a lesson? What's the best way to for a child to learn? Experience. How do you learn how to drive a car? By reading the driver's manual? No, especially not if it's stick shift. Okay. How do you learn that a stove is hot? You touch it. Okay. Unfortunately, most people have to learn by experience. So, Antony gives him a valid life lesson. And you can probably safely imagine it sunk in to this poor brother. Number 12. A brother said to Serapion, "Give me a word." Serapion replies, what can I say to you? "You have taken what belongs to widows and orphans and put it on your window ledge." And we get this image that the brother is standing facing Serapion, and Serapion is looking behind the brother to his window ledge that is full of books. "You've taken what belongs to widows and orphans and put it on your window ledge." Does he mean those books belong to widows and orphans?
Money to buy them.
Yeah, it means the money to buy them or the money to produce them does. Last year when I taught this course, reread John Chrysostom's, a little book of some homilies of John Chrysostom called On Wealth and Poverty. Okay, I didn't do it this time because it was a little much for some of the students last time. Because Chrysostom essentially says, if you have two pairs of shoes, that second pair of shoes, you've stolen it from somebody else who doesn't have any pairs of shoes. If you've got, like I do, you know, 10 coats hanging in your closet, then you're stealing from 9 other people who don't have a coat at all. Okay? Basil the Great writes a lot about this also, that if you have excess, that excess is stolen, his words, stolen from those who have nothing. Okay? That's why the brother says this. Go on to fortitude. Number 8. Peman said about John the Short that he asked the Lord to take away his passions. Now, notice the earlier couple of statements that we read, the hermits don't ask to have their passions taken away. They ask for patience to endure those passions. Okay. Peman said about St. John the Short, or about John the Short, that he asked the Lord to take away his passions. So his heart was at rest, and he went to a hermit and said, "I find that I'm at peace, with no war between flesh and spirit." That is, his soul is at perfect peace with his body. And what's the hermit say? Go ask the Lord to stir up a new war in you. Fighting is good for the soul. When the conflict revived in him, he no longer prayed for it to be taken away, but instead said, "Lord, give me strength to endure this fight." Okay? Give me strength to endure. To endure means to withstand whatever the fight was, the temptation was. But it's not to have that temptation taken away. Okay? Now, some of this, I think, could be really beneficial for our society. Because our society essentially says, one, if it feels good, do it. Okay? But it also says the highest good in society is to be what? Without pain. That's why we are such a heavily medicated society. Okay? To be without pain, that pain is somehow bad for us. Yet pain isn't bad. Pain is a warning. It's telling us, don't do X, Y, or Z, you know. You binge drink, what's going to happen? You're going to barf all over the place. Therefore, maybe I shouldn't binge drink, kind of a mentality. Number 13, Pieman again. Pieman said, the character of the genuine monk only appears when he is tempted. Okay? Only appears when he is tempted. Is it a sacrifice to do something that you want to do for somebody else? No. Is it a sacrifice if you're not busy and someone calls and says, hey, I've got a flat tire. Can you come over and change it for me? Not likely to happen with all women in the course, but, you know. Or can you come help me move? No, that's not a sacrifice. When is it a sacrifice? When you've got exams to study for, papers to write, work to go to, blah, 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 blah. Hey, can you come? No, I'm too busy. Okay? That's what he means. It's when you're too busy to do something that the test really matters. Number 17, a long one by Synkletika. Synkletika also said, if you're troubled by illness, do not be miserable. Even if you're so ill that you cannot stand a prayer, use your voice to say psalms. We need these tribulations to destroy the desires of our body. They serve the same purpose as fasting and austerity. So, someone who is really ill, that illness, according to Synkletika, that illness can be their form of fasting, their form of self-denial. If your senses are dulled by illness, you do not need to fast. This is something, you know, modern Orthodox converts need to learn. I've been Orthodox or been becoming Orthodox for 20 years now. I know a lot of people, they'll get sick, and because Lent has begun, they think, oh, I still need to fast. You know, and I try to tell them, no, you don't. You're already sick. Your body is already, quote unquote, fasting from health. There's no need to do more. If your senses are dulled by illness, you do not need to fast. In the same way that a powerful medicine cures an illness, so illness itself is a medicine to cure passion. Notice, she's not saying, like a lot of people will say, oh, well, the illness is a sign of what? Sin. It's because you've offended God in some way. A great deal is gained spiritually by bearing illness quietly and giving thanks to God. If we go blind, let us not be upset. We have lost one means to excellence, yet we can contemplate the glory of God with the inward eyes of the soul. If we go deaf, let us remember that we shall no longer hear a lot of silly talk. If suffering has weakened the strength of your hands, you still have inner strength against the enemy's attacks. If the whole body is afflicted by disease, your spiritual health is still increasing. And I'm trying to remember the title of this short story written by Tolstoy. What is that story's name? It's about a young girl, young peasant girl, who comes down with a disease, and she's essentially bedridden. And earlier in her life, She had been young and beautiful and vivacious. I mean, when I say earlier, when she was in her teens, the young girl is still in her 20s. But she's now completely bedridden. Bedridden, can barely move. And she is now in her early 20s, inhabiting a small hut on the outskirts of a village in the vast expanse of Russia. Okay, and a man comes hunting, and he hears a little noise, and he comes in and sees her and speaks with her. And the man is one who had been a suitor of hers when she was in her teens, when she was young and beautiful and vivacious and all this kind of stuff. And he realizes who she is, and he asks, is there anything I can do for you? And she just asks, can you move me a little bit towards the sunlight so that she can look out at the flowers in the meadow? The whole story, okay, is about his learning from her about the joy of life. Okay, and yet, here's a person who can't move, who can't do anything, who used to have full use of her body. Somebody comes from the village once a day to give her a piece of bread and a little bit of water. Okay, and he's learning from her about the joy of life. Man, I wish I could remember the title of that. Read it earlier this spring. I mean, it just blew my socks off because I'd never read it before. If I remember it, I'll send it to you. Number 23. A hermit said, we do not make progress because we do not realize how much we can do. We lose interest in the work we have begun, and we want to be good without even trying. Well, what does he mean? We lose interest in the work we have begun. Okay, could be instant gratification. What's the opposite of the instant gratification? I mean, what does instant gratification or the desire for instant gratification do? It dulls diligence. It dulls industriousness. We think, or I'll say I think, that if I can't do something well the first time, it's not worth doing. Well, how many of us can do something well the first time? I mean, you write a paper and it's perfect. First draft. Not many of us can do that. Okay? Or you pick up a new exercise regimen or something, and you tell yourself, I'm going to walk, or I'm going to run, or I'm going to swim 30 minutes a day, and 10 minutes in, you're exhausted. You give up, say, no, I'm not going to do that, I'm going to be a couch potato. Okay, what he means with the first line, we don't realize how much we can do, is we sell ourselves short. We don't see that with a little hard work, we can actually do these things. With a little hard work, and I didn't learn this till I was a senior in college. It actually took me getting married to buckle down. You know, with a little hard work on the front side of the semester, I could actually write pretty good papers and get A's and B's in courses. Rather than just being lazy and waiting till the last minute, and writing a paper knowing, I can slough off a pretty easy B without doing a lot of work. But doing a lot of work raised that sloughed off B to an A. Okay, that's what he's talking about. Number 45. A hermit said, if you fall ill, do not complain. Now, I don't know about you, but he could have stopped right there. How many of you have gotten, you know, ill where it just, you just couldn't seem to shake it? And it just keeps coming back. And so you complained. I mean, 9 times out of 10, it seems like, maybe 7 times out of 10. When I get on Facebook now, somebody's complaining about some illness. Okay? If the Lord God has willed that your body should be weakened, who are you to complain about it? Okay, now notice, first of all, what that is assuming. If you are ill, it's because God wants you to be ill. Okay, so if God wants you to be ill, then should one necessarily second guess? Does he not care for you in all your needs? What is, you know, the book of Ecclesiastes entirely about? To every time there is a season. Okay? Season for good health, season for bad health, season for, let's extrapolate it to modern day, season for good grades, season for bad grades, season for a car that writes, that runs well, season for a car that doesn't run. Surely you would not be alive without him. Be patient in your illness and ask God to give you what is right. What's the danger in that, though?
What you think is right?
Yeah, because what I think is right probably is going
to be...
Yeah, exactly. It's right for me to be healthy, wealthy, wise, and rich. Okay, batting 0 for 4, you know, so far. Ask God to give you what is right. And then the hermit tells us what that means. That which will enable you to do his will. And be patient. And eat what you have in charity. That is, in love. That is, pray to God that he will give you the strength to do his will, be patient, and eat what you have in charity. What does that mean in charity? In love. Gratitude. In thankfulness. Okay? I don't know if I have it. Yeah, I do. Section 8, nothing done for show. Peeman also said, teach your heart to follow what your tongue is saying to others. He also said, men try to appear excellent in preaching, but they are less excellent in practicing what they preach. Okay. Nothing done for show implies let your actions match your words, period. So that means you don't do anything above and beyond what you normally do if what you normally do isn't above and beyond. Okay? Number 19, Syncletica again. She's got some pretty good zingers in here. An open treasury is quickly spent. That is, you go into your room and you see a bunch of cash laying on your dresser. If you're like me, that cash won't be laying on your dresser very long. Any virtue will be lost if it is published abroad and is known about everywhere. So what's the open treasury? Reputation for good works. If you put wax in front of a fire, it melts. If you pour vain praises on the soul, it goes soft and weak in seeking goodness. Let's extrapolate to today. What might she be suggesting for, possibly, parents and teachers of young children? What is I will call it an epidemic in United States culture?
Spoiling kids.
Louder?
Spoiling kids.
Okay, you're close to what I'm looking for. How?
Everybody's a winner.
Everybody's, you know, I know Caitlin went to Blackman High School. There are no quote-unquote regular classes at Blackman. There's honors, advanced honors, and AP. There's no non-honors. That is, everybody, by the virtue of being a student there, is above average. What's the problem with that? It says you don't have to work for anything. Okay? What does she mean when she says, wax melts before the fire, and if you pour vain praises on the soul, it goes soft and weak in seeking goodness. Exactly. Johnny, you are wonderful. You're so smart. You're so brilliant. It doesn't matter that you didn't get 100 on that test. Okay? Or, you know, back when I was coaching soccer, the fact that everybody gets a trophy. Okay? There is a huge problem with that. Because what does that mean? Everybody's a winner. No. Not true. Not everybody's a winner. The team that wins the game wins. I actually used to tell this sometimes to my 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12-year-old players. If you don't win, you are a loser. Okay? You lost the game. Does that mean you're a horrible subhuman person? No. What does it mean, though? If you want to win, what must you do? Try harder. If you didn't get 100 on the exam and you wanted 100 on the exam, what must you do? Come and ask for extra credit? No. Try harder. Work. So when she talks about the soul going soft, what does she mean? If we continually praise people, what do they start to think about themselves? This is the number one problem in American education, that it's all about self-esteem. There have been a whole bunch of studies and a whole bunch of polls done worldwide in terms of the industrialized countries. American students always poll number one in self-esteem. They think the best about themselves of all students in the Western industrialized countries. But then when they're polled about, you know, things like, oh, facts, like basic geography, they're usually towards the bottom of the list in terms of basic knowledge, like being able to place, you know, Africa on a world map. I'm not kidding. Or being able to place World War II in the right century. I'm not kidding. Or the Civil War in the right century. Okay? So they think very highly of themselves. And on the other part, they're not that bright in terms of some of this basic kind of knowledge. Okay? Why? Because they've been told it doesn't matter. Because you're wonderful just the way you are. In fact, I think there's a song with those exact lyrics. Number 9, non-judgment. A brother sinned, number 2, and the presbyter ordered him to go out of church. That is, the priest. But Bessarion got up, went out with him, saying, I too am a sinner. There's a reason the church is called a hospital for sinners. It's where you go to get well. Okay? You know, what does Christ say? The healthy don't need a physician. I'm here for the sick. Look at number 3. When Isaac of the Thebaid visited a community, he saw that one of the brothers was sinful, passed sentence on him. But when he was returning to his cell in the desert, the angel of the Lord came and stood in front of the door of his cell and said, I will not let you go in. Why not? Okay, first of all, who are you to question an angel? Where do you tell me to send that sinful brother whom you sentenced? And Isaac's like, oops, sorry. I have sinned, forgive me. The angel said, get up, God has forgiven you. In future, take care to judge no man before God has judged him. Okay? What did he do? He passed sentence. He judged. The angel says, don't judge any man until God judges. And if we take that second judges in relation to the first, what does that mean? Until God passes sentence. Well, when is that? The quote-unquote final judgment. What does that mean? It means judge no man lost until God says that person is lost. Mike Huckabee, Osama bin Laden will rot in hell. Don't know about that. Okay. Number four, in Sadis, a brother was once found guilty. So obviously what had to have happened? There was some kind of court. They assembled the brothers, sent a message to Moses telling him to come. But he wouldn't come. So then the priest sent a message again. Come, for the gathering of monks is waiting for you. Moses got up and goes. He takes with him an old basket, which he filled with sand and carried on his back. They went to meet him and they said, what's this mean? He said, my sins run out behind me and I do not see them. And I've come here today to judge another. They listened to him and said no more to the brother who had sinned, but forgave him. His way of saying, let him who is without sin cast the first stone. Number five, Joseph asked Peman, tell me how to become a monk. If you want to find rest in this life and the next, say it every moment. Who am I? And judge no one. How many of you saw, I probably shouldn't ask this, but I will. How many of you saw Les Mis? The one with Hugh Jackman and Amanda Seyfried and all those. Remember the song when he sings, Who Am I? Okay. How many of you, when you left Les Mis, felt different? When I saw it, it was life-changing, okay? Here's why. That film was the most quote-unquote Christian thing I've ever seen in a film without being quote-unquote Christian, okay? And it is heavily based on Victor Hugo's novel, that is, the modern lyricist and writer for the film and everything, they're not just, you know, taking Victor Hugo's basic idea and transforming it. They're taking what is already there and condensing it, okay? Because the novel's, you know, like 1,000 pages long. Victor Hugo could definitely have used a good editor. But that scene, Who Am I? What is it saying? Taylor? What is he saying?
Is he more than a thief and is he more than this number?
Okay. When does that song happen? From? Okay. Is it before or after the attempted robbery of the church?
After.
It's after. And what happens when he robs the church?
He robs the kindness.
Okay.
The priest gives him the candlesticks.
He takes everything and the priest says, take these two. Okay. What does the priest not do? He doesn't condemn him. What else doesn't he do? Doesn't try to take it back. What does he do when the police bring Jean Valjean back with the silver? That's when he gives him the candlesticks. Okay? He says, no, I gave him all that, but he forgot these. He gives him the candlesticks then. And that's when Jean Valjean goes out and sings, Who Am I? What's he asking? Am I merely a condemned sinner? Okay? Am I merely a thief? Well, what happens after that situation where the priest gives him the candlesticks and he sings the song? Is he a thief? No. Okay. He changes his life. And what does he do with it?
Gives back.
Gives back. Quote, unquote, pays it forward. He changes his life. Who am I and judge no one? What does Jean Valjean never do to Javert? He never judges him. You know, you get that final scene with the two of them together. And what does... He could kill him, right? Javert has been hunting him for 20 years. And he doesn't. What does he do? He says, I don't blame you at all. Why? Because Javert is doing his job. Javert is doing the best he can with what he knows. And when Jean Valjean shows mercy to him, Javert takes the swan dive. Why?
He can't imagine.
He can't accept it. It doesn't fit into his worldview. Because Javert is all about judging. Okay? Number six. A brother said to Piment, if I see my brother sin, is it really right not to tell anyone about it? He doesn't mean to tell my brother. He means to go and tell, like, the abbot. Oh, you know, John over there, he's sinning. Should I? When we cover our brother's sin, God covers our sin. What does he mean by covers? No. He, louder.
I was going to say, with the blood of Christ.
Possibly. I mean, because he might mean by that, forgive. What does Christ say? If you forgive another their sins, what? Their sins are forgiven. If you retain someone else's sins, their sins are retained.
Okay. Wait, what does that mean?
Well, just think about that phrase for a minute, or that clause. If you forgive someone their sins are forgiven. If you retain, that is, if you don't forgive someone their sins, then their sins are not forgiven. Let that sink in. What does that mean? If one accepts that literally.
That means if you don't forgive your brother, then their sins are not forgiven.
And what happens if your sins are not forgiven? According to Christ. So what does that mean? If we take Christ's words literally, what does that mean? Each person has the power to do.
To ban your brother?
Yes. That's why the Lord's Prayer has what clause in it?
Forgive us our trespasses.
Forgive us our trespasses. What's the next word? As. As what? As we forgive those who trespass against us. So what is that prayer saying? God, forgive me just as I forgive others. So if I don't forgive others, what am I saying? Don't forgive me. Judge not lest you be judged. Why? Because according to how you judge, so will it be meted out to you. That's pretty radical language. Okay. And what all of these monks are doing is they're attempting to fully live out the gospel. Okay? When we cover our brother's sin, God covers our sin. Just one second, Caroline. So that might mean forgives. What might it also mean? If I keep it hidden, if I don't tell anyone, when we tell people about our brother's guilt, God does the same with ours. Meaning, God makes it known. He doesn't hide it. He doesn't forget it. He doesn't cover it. Okay, Caroline?
I was going to say, the language here with the covers of the sin reminds me of Noah and his sons. One of them goes and tells, and the other one literally covered his sin.
Yep. And what do the two brothers do? They walk backwards to cover up Noah. What else does it go back to? It goes back to the beginning of Genesis. Okay? Adam and Eve are naked. It's only after they sin that they are given covers, covering, animal skins. According to almost all the fathers of the church, if they had never sinned, they would have been given garments. But they wouldn't have been garments of skin. They would have been garments of light. They would have put on, to use the language of St. Basil, the likeness of God. Okay? They would have put on righteousness, which would be a covering. Okay? Look at number 9. Once there was a meeting of monks in Satis, and they discussed the case of a guilty brother, but Peor said nothing. Afterwards, this is a lot like the one with Moses that we read earlier. Afterwards, he, Peor, got up, went out, took a sack, filled it with sand, carried it on his shoulders. He put a little sand in a basket and carried it in front of him. The monks are like, what are you doing? The sack with a lot of sand is my sins, and they are many. So I put them on my back. Then I shall not weep for them. Okay? If they're back here, what can he not do? He can't see them. The basket with a little sand is the sins of our brother, and they are right in front of me, and I see them, and I judge them. Meaning what? It's easy to see other people's faults. It's a lot harder to see our own. This is not right. I ought to have my own sins in front of me and think about them and ask God to forgive me. Okay? Remember the prayer of St. Ephrem that I handed out last week? You know? What's he say? Teach me what? To see my own sins and not to judge my brother. Okay? Go on to discretion. What is discretion? The ability to discern right from wrong. The ability to show wisdom. Look at number 10. They said of Agatho that some people went to him because they heard he was a man of great discretion. That is wisdom. Wanting to test whether he was irritable, they said to him, "Are you Agatho? We've heard of you that you're an adulterer and a proud man." He said, "Yep, that's me." "Are you that Agatho who gossips and slanders?" "Yep, that's me." "Are you Agatho the heretic?" "I am no heretic." "Whoa, whoa, whoa, stop. You know, you accept the first four charges, but you don't accept the heresy? Why did you patiently bear it when we slandered you, but did not endure it when we said you were a heretic?" He said, "I have agreed to the first charges against myself for the good of my soul." Okay. One, was he really an adulterer and a proud man? No. Was he really a gossip and slanderer? No. But he says he accepts it for the good of his soul. Okay. "But I didn't accept it when you said I was a heretic." Why? Because to be a heretic means to be separated from God. And I don't want to be separated from God. Okay, so why does he accept the first four?
Okay. Well, they're accusations against his goodness, his soul.
Okay.
It's humbling.
Yeah, it's humbling. And what you'll see, not just, you know, in this section, throughout the writings of the Desert Fathers, they say, accept whatever someone else says against you. Accept it and turn the other cheek. That is, do not reply in kind. If someone calls you a liar, just turn away. If someone says something bad or ill about you, accept it. Okay? They admired his discretion and went away edified. Number 21. Ephraim was passing by when a harlot, she was the devil's agent, began to make every effort to attract him to sinful intercourse, or if she failed in this, at least to stir him to anger, for no one had ever seen him angry or brawling. And he says to her, come with me. They get to a crowded place, you know, let's say it's a mall. They get to the middle of Cool Springs Galleria. And he says, okay, come on, let's do it right here, right now, in front of everybody. She's like, can't do it here. With all these people around, we should be ashamed. If you blush before men, should you not blush the more before God, who discloses the hidden things of darkness? She goes back confused and taken aback. Okay? Without gaining anything. In other words, whoosh, completely over her head. His point is what? You can't do anything that hides from God. You need a modern example? Read Nathaniel Hawthorne's The Minister's Black Veil. Okay? Number 33. Not even going to get nearly through. 33. Longinus asked Lucius, I have three ideas, and the first is to go on a pilgrimage. And Lucius says, if you do not control your tongue, you will never be a pilgrim wherever you travel. But control your tongue here, and you will be a pilgrim without traveling. Okay, so Longinus takes that one, checks it. Probably, my reading is, he's like, okay, let's see what he says about idea number two. My second idea is to fast for 2 days at a time. Lucius says, the prophet Isaiah said, even if you bend your neck to the ground, your fast will not so be accepted. You rather should guard your mind from evil thoughts. And Longinus, okay, just kind of stores that one aside and says, my third idea is to avoid the company of men. Lucius says, unless you first deal with your sins by living among men, you will not be able to deal with yourself when you live alone. So, Longinus has three ideas. These are three ideas that he thinks will help him develop spiritually, will help him attain or advance towards perfection. One, go on a pilgrimage. Two, fast 2 days at a time. And three, leave the company of men. And Lucius says what to him? Pilgrimages don't matter. Fasting without the right mindset doesn't matter. And living by yourself in the desert doesn't matter. If what? If you're not able to live with yourself among the company of men. In other words, you will not be able to live without temptation by yourself in the desert if you're not first able to live without temptation among people. So in each of the three things, he's saying, you know, watch what you say. Then you'll be a real pilgrim. Okay? Watch your attitude. Then you will really be fasting. Three, deal with your sins first in living with people. What does that mean? He's saying, don't sin against others. Only when you've achieved that can you then go off and live into the desert. Number 44, Joseph asks Peman, how should we fast? And Peman says, I suggest everyone should eat a little less than he wants every day. Now, that's the kind of spiritual director I would like. You know, eat a little bit less than you want. So let's say I want 2 Big Macs. Just eat one. Let's say I want 3 scoops of ice cream for dessert. Just eat 2. Notice what he's not saying. Eat one little meal of bread and water. Joseph says, when you were a young man, didn't you fast for 2 days on end? Notice, Peman has said, here's what people should do. Eat a little bit less than they want. That is fasting. And then Joseph said, yeah, but when you were younger, didn't you fast for 2 days on end? That, yeah. Actually, I used to fast 3 days on end, but who's counting? Even for a week, he would fast. But the great hermits have tested all these things, and they found that it is good to eat something every day, but on some days a little less. They have shown us that this is the king's highway. Why? Because it's easy and light. Notice what Peeman is not doing. He's not laying a huge burden when the person comes and asks for advice. He's giving him a light burden, an easy yoke. Fifty-three. He also said, whoever the he is, it's a monk. I guess it's Peeman if it goes back to 48. No, that's actually, go back to 48 first. Peeman said, if a man sins and denies it, saying, I have not sinned, do not correct him, or you will destroy any intention he might have of changing. If you say, do not be cast down, my brother, but be careful about that in future, you will move his heart to repent. Somebody comes up to you and says, oh, I never lie. Don't say, you lying, dirty, rotten son of a blah, 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 blah. Because what will that do? That's just going to harden that person. I mean, what do we all naturally do if someone accuses us of something? We put up our defenses. So instead he says, do what? If someone says, you know, I don't lie, whatever, well, you know, don't do it anymore. Then he says, you soften the heart to repent. Now 53. What in the world is that? It's like four, somebody banging at a door to get in. He also said, evil cannot drive out evil. If anyone hurts you, do good to him, and your good will destroy his evil. And I think that has two meanings. One, it will destroy his evil intent toward you, but it will also destroy the evil in him. Okay? That is, your doing good to him will cancel out his evil. Another brother, 55, comes to Peeman and says, many thoughts come into my mind, put me in danger. And so he says, go outside and open your lungs to the air, but don't breathe. So go outside and go, but don't breathe. Can't. Just as you can't stop air coming into your lungs, so you can't stop thoughts coming into your mind. We can't stop those thoughts. Your part is to resist them. Not necessarily all thoughts, okay? But he's talking about the many thoughts that put him in danger. He says, those thoughts are going to come, but what do? You resist them. Notice discretion is, I believe, the longest section. No, I won't do that one. Go real quickly. Nah, I think we'll just stop there because it's almost 11:05. No, 26, very last one. This is on humility. Right. Sorry, the section on humility, which is... yeah, it's on page 156 in mine. It's number 26. Humility is number 15. Mercurius was once returning to his cell from the marsh carrying palm leaves. The devil met him, by the way, with a sickle. Wanted to run him through with it, but he could not. The devil said, Mercurius, I suffer a lot of violence from you, for I can't overcome you. Whatever you do, I do also. If you fast, I eat nothing. If you keep watch, I get no sleep. There's only one quality in which you surpass me. What? Humility. That's why I cannot prevail against you. Why? Because the devil has no humility. After all, what made him the devil? I will ascend above the seat of the Most High. Number 28, the nearer a man comes to God, the more he sees himself to be a sinner. We kind of think, or I kind of think, I won't say you do, the nearer a man comes to God, the more holy that person becomes. Yes, but what does that mean? The more rotten he sees that he is. It's not in here, but Sisoes, and I'll stop with this one. Sisoes, who is mentioned several times, said on his deathbed, his disciples came to him and they said, Abba, tell us what you see. Or Abba, give us a word. That is, give us your last statement of wisdom. And he says, I see heaven opened up and I see the angels. Pray for me, a sinner. And he dies. That's it. Okay, papers next Tuesday. I should have all...